Let's start off with our little Commodore 116 here, which, as the story goes from Bill Hurd, who was one of the chief designers of the machine, he was given a Timex machine out of a Commodore filing cabinet. And they basically said, look, this is our competition. We want to have a nice cheap business machine, preferably for around $50. And they had a chipset ready, which was the TED chipset, or the text editing display. And him and his team went off and basically designed the machine we've got in front of us here. I mean, I often think, in a lot of ways, this is a perfect little retro computer, because the games load in no time at all, because they're tiny, because by the time it's loaded, it's basic, it's only got 12.7 out of 16K anyway.
Yeah.
And if you use its high-res mode, it has 4K. So no one does. But it's more colourful than Commodore 64, it's capable of more colours.
And what came first then, this or the 64?
Oh, this 64 was first.
So off the back of that, they were thinking, right, we've sold some good computers here, let's do something even better, I guess.
Well, it wasn't even better, no, they wanted cheaper. So the Commodore 64 was relatively expensive for a mid-range budget computer, and they were really keen to get one on the market that would compete with the likes of Timex and TI-99 and all the other cheap companies of the day. But as it turned out, the machine was left with absolutely nowhere to go, because Texas Instruments exited the market, so did Timex. So it's a mixture of bad business decisions and bad timing, really.
What era are we here?
It's like 81, 82, I believe. And it took an awfully long time for anything to happen, because I think there were a fair few of internal squabbles going on at Commodore at the time. So the Commodore 64 would have been still the flagship of Commodore's range. And then these were supposed to be much, much cheaper machines. There were no frills. They certainly weren't designed for gaming, so they had no sprite capability. The sound chip was rudimentary, I would suggest. It had one big chip that did the sound and most of the other functions. And yeah, they were not really meant for entertainment. But of course, the world of computing in the early 80s, that's kind of what people expected. If you actually look inside it, it's a very, very nicely engineered machine. But very quickly, the powers that be at Commodore put their thinking heads together, and they came up with three more machines. So they came up with the C232, the C264, which still gives the series its name, and the V364, which was to be like the top end machine. So you'd have had the 116 at the bottom, 232, 264, and V364. And the 116, not much happened with that for quite a little while. They were concentrating on the 232. So they're all the same chipset, it just depends how much memory or features they had. So the 232 had 32K of memory, and it was in exactly the same case as our Plus 4. Then there was the C264, which has obviously 64K of RAM. And then the top end one was the V364, which for some reason that I can't fathom, had speech synthesis built in. So the team that designed the Speak and Spell, they actually put a lady's voice into the V364. Very, very quickly, they ditched the 232, and the Commodore 116, I think they produced about 50,000 of them. All but a few ended up in Germany. We've got boxed one over here. It looks like someone took a knife to it at some point and tried to stab the box to death. So yeah, that's all in German.
When you think of, say, the Commodore 64, it's got this very slab-like appearance. This one, not so much. Was the designer in-house?
The case was designed in Japan, as I think most of the machine was, and it's a cultural thing, I guess. So it does look very, very nice. And it's the one thing that drew me to the series in the first place. I did really like the look of the machine, and that made me more curious about it, and it was one of the first retro computers I got hold of.
So this is, I mean, we're here at the Centre for Computing History, but this is your machine, right?
This is my machine, yes.
So you've brought that especially in for us?
I have, yes. So I have two Commodore 116s. I have got one in my case over there, which is a very low serial number. So that's number, what is it? 1512. So this is the one I tend to take the more care of. So that's looked after, keep the dust and the light off of it. And then a little while ago, I got hold of this one because I've never seen one in a box with my own eyes. So to get hold of one in a box
And was that from a popular auction website?
It was indeed, yes. From a very Commodore-oriented seller, shall we say. So it was fully restored as well, which was another big plus.
What needs to be done to a machine like that then?
Well, the Commodore 116 has this very, it's a chiclet keyboard. So like the Spectrum, but the keys are even smaller and they do tend to roll about on your finger. What tends to go wrong with the keyboard is the connector will start to fray and it's almost impossible to replace. Other things that you would need to be very careful of with the whole series is the TED chip or the 8360 and the processors, which is a 7501 or 8501, depending what machine you've got, they get very, very hot. So my advice is if you ever fancy getting hold of one of these machines, don't even turn it on to try it. Put the heat sinks on before you even fire it up because those chips get amazingly hot. As a little retro machine, I do quite like the series because, you know, you just want a quick fix of gaming. They're only short little arcade games usually and they load in a couple of minutes, even off of a cassette. So I do quite like it for that. Other things we should point out about the machine is, of course, it does not have the usual Atari-like connectors for joysticks. I've read on the internet, that's to keep it incompatible with the Commodore 64 and other machines. It wasn't. It's purely because this was the one and only vision for this series. And the big 9-pin Atari connector simply just did not fit in the case. So they had to come up with these little DIN plugs. And that, of course, carried on to the cassette player here. The only one that is the same as the Commodore 64 is the serial for printers and disk drives. Things it does have, which other machines of its ilk do not have, we have actually got a reset button.
It's almost console-like in its shaping, actually, with the venting on the back.
As I said before, it needs the venting. Certainly, they knew they had a problem with heat, because underneath the keyboard here, we've got a great big metal plate, and that metal plate has got two prongs. One goes down onto the processor, one goes down onto the TED chip to actually keep it a little bit cool. Something they didn't carry on entirely into the rest of the series that eventually did arrive.
When this machine was being kind of created and designed and thought out, we got Jack Tramiel at the reins at Commodore, but he was soon to leave. So did that have an impact on this?
Had an enormous impact on this series. It was a victim of timing as well, in that he was very, very scared of the Japanese flooding the market with cheap computer imports. And he was also really worried about the budget computers of Sinclair and Texas Instruments. And so that's why he wanted Commodore to have their own cheap computer to compete with them. But very shortly after this was completed, this version, the Texas Instruments left the market, so did Timex. And the reported influx of machines from Japan simply didn't happen. So it was a victim of timing with that. And then Jack Tramiel was having problems with the board at Commodore. There's various stories around the internet of what those problems were. And the last act that he ever did for Commodore was at the CES show, where he is photographed holding the V364 and the 264. Where they were launched at that show. What happened next was a mixture of marketing people getting involved and some rather strange design choices that made it very, very hard for the machines that followed to survive in the marketplace.
And this was kind of a footnote to that, you know, and there might be a prototype of things like the Spectrum and whatever. So, okay, vaguely interested, you know.
It would be absolutely amazing if in a moment I could jump up and hit my head on a block and something appears out of it. I do think there might be a Japanese company reaching for the phone at some point.